On This Week in Enterprise Tech, the FCC tries to crack the set-top box monopoly, AT&T wiggles out of a responsibility, and if you're using a PC to drive your digital signage, you're doing it wrong. Twiet on the set.
Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is Twiet.
Bandwidth for This Week in Enterprise Tech is provided by CacheFly at CacheFly.com.
This is Twiet, This Week in Enterprise Tech, episode 206, recorded September 9th, 2016. Bright Sign. This Week in Enterprise Tech is literally brought to you by Sonic, Twiet's 10-gig fiber internet service provider. Join Sonic's internet revolution as they bring fast, affordable internet, phone, and TV to homes and businesses all over California. Visit sonic.com/twiet to sign up for service and receive your first month free. Welcome to Twiet, This Week in Enterprise Tech. It's the show dedicated to the enterprise professional, the IT pro, and the geek who just wants to know how the world is connected. I'm your host, Father Robert Ballasaire, the digital Jesuit, your guide to all things in the enterprise. But I don't guide you by myself. For that, I rely on my good friends, my colleagues, starting with Mr. Brian Chi. He is the director of the Advanced Network Computing Laboratory in Honolulu, Hawaii. Brian, you just dodged a couple of big storms. How are you doing as the geek in paradise?
Well, actually, my buddy from the Central Hurricane Center of the Pacific was showing me all these really cool pictures that he got off the satellites. One of them looks like Cookie Monster, and that actually got picked up and has gone viral. The other one actually is just the leftover clouds, and it looks like Papa Smurf staring at the islands. You can see all kinds of really cool things in the clouds.
Well, I'm glad that the storms missed you then, because it would be horrible to have Cookie Monster and Papa Smurf kick the snot out of the Hawaiian Islands. Now, someone who is not being beat up by 80s cartoon characters is Mr. Curtis Franklin from Information Week Radio. Curtis Franklin, you're not getting any hurricanes over there, are you?
Well, this time last week we were. Hermine came through the edges of our neighborhood. We ended up in pretty good shape here at the Swamp Studio, but had to go out and pick up lots of tree parts nonetheless. Today, though, it's a beautiful sunny day here in Florida, and it's a great time to be on Twiet.
Indeed. Now, we've got a fantastic episode planned for our fans. If you've ever tried to set up digital signage, I mean professional grade digital signage, not just some rando guy with a laptop hooked up to a big screen, you're going to want to stay tabbed, because we've got Jeff Hastings, the CEO of BrightSign, who's going to show you the right way to do your signage. But before that, let's jump into the blips. Now, FCC Chairman Tom Wheeler is tilting at windmills again, and this time he's going after set-top operators. Fierce opposition from Comcast, AT&T, and a dozen other network operators and content studios have tried to stymie Wheeler's attempt to open the $20 billion a year satellite and cable set-top box monopoly by regulating the inclusion of app access to network-delivered pay TV content. It's estimated that a successful regulation of the pay TV market would allow about 100 million users to replace their expensive and often under-featured set-top boxes, whose rental prices have jumped 185% since 1994, even as the cost of TVs, computers, and mobile devices have dropped 90% in the same time frame. Specifically, Wheeler is proposing a framework and licensing body for devices and services that can access all the content from Netflix, Amazon, Hulu, YouTube, and pay TV providers without the need for proprietary and locked down set-top boxes. The providers have countered with a plan to make their own apps that they promise will probably at some point maybe include some of the functionality that Wheeler is asking for.
Hey, did you notice Dell now owns RSA? While we're all trying to digest what Dell owning EMC means, buried in all the news is that Dell also took possession of RSA this week. That means that Dell now controls what is arguably the best-known IT security firm in the world. RSA's president, Amit Yoran, has said that RSA will maintain complete brand autonomy, which is a fancy way of saying that Dell will pretty much keep their hands off, and the history of Dell's behavior toward companies they've acquired supports Yoran's statement. In preparation for the EMC purchase, Dell spun off SecureWorks and SonicWall so the Round Rock giant isn't trying to become a security juggernaut. Still, it will be interesting to see how Dell incorporates RSA into their broader offerings and whether the annual RSA conference takes on some spicy Texas flavor in its next version.
Well, a new device can open a locked Windows or Mac in seconds, kind of like that little thing that Artie has in Warehouse 13. Well, Rob Fuller, a principal security engineer at R5 Industries, have used flash drive size computers to break the user hash on both Mac and Windows PCs that were logged in but on locked screen. His statement goes on to say that this was dead easy to do and should not have worked, but did. The gist is that these devices pretended to be a USB Ethernet device and offered a DHCP address to the machine, and then using an open source program called Responder, was able to get authentication tokens. I'm really looking forward to Padre being able to interview this guy in the relatively near future.
Indeed. Oh, by the way, Dell and EMC, dude, you're getting a pink slip. With the $67 billion acquisition of EMC by Dell finally complete, it was only a matter of time before we saw a reduction in the combined workforce of more than 140,000 employees. And that time is now. Word has reached the streets that Dell plans to shave 2,000 to 3,000 jobs, mostly from overlaps in supply chain, admin, and marketing pools. The reduction, which, to be fair, is at most 2% of the total workforce, should save Dell $1.7 billion in the first year and a half of operation. It should be noted that Dell is projecting that the boost to sales by combining the world's top manufacturers of data storage products and PCs/servers should eclipse that savings several-fold. Still, with such a large acquisition, there are bound to be more areas of overlap that will see the elimination of redundant positions.
Hey, in case you were wondering, you might want to rethink giving Galaxy Note 7s to your road warriors. In the wake of Samsung's hot new smartphone getting hotter than anyone would like, the FAA has come out with a strong recommendation that you leave the Galaxy Note 7 on the ground if you're going to fly. The administration stopped short of an outright ban, but they did highly recommend that no one use or recharge the phones in an airplane. Samsung has recalled all of the units already sold, but if you're one of those stubborn fans who just can't stand the thought of giving up your new phone, plan on carrying it in a nice fireproof box if you need to fly.
Did Mylan Pharmaceuticals force schools into an anti-competition contract? On Tuesday, New York Attorney General Eric Schneiderman announced that his office is investigating Mylan Pharmaceuticals Incorporated, the maker of the EpiPen, for potentially using anti-competitive terms in contracts it had with many school systems. Those terms allowed the schools to receive Mylan's EpiPens for free or at discounted prices as long as they didn't buy any competitors' products for a year. Mylan states that this requirement is no longer part of the contract, but did not state when that clause was removed. This really looks like Mylan has been playing dirty with their massive price hikes supported by anti-competitive contracts to support these new prices.
Google wants a bigger piece of the enterprise pie, and now they're putting their checkbook to work. Yesterday, Google announced their acquisition of enterprise software vendor Apigee for $625 million. Apigee, which went public last year, is both an API toolset and a secure backend service that lets enterprises tie together business and consumer-facing services in a set of mobile APIs. In other words, Google now has a cloud service that can play the middleman for the likes of AT&T, Walgreens, Burberry, and other vendors who pay a fraction of a cent every time they hit the API. Apigee has been growing well for the past three quarters, increasing revenue by 34% year over year and increasing their customer base from 115 customers to 300. Yet it still posted a $32 million loss on $66.9 million of revenue. Google is betting that their existing infrastructure and cloud service ecosystem will allow them to appeal to the same transactional customers while also giving them access and potentially buy-in to Google's higher-end analytic tools.
Hey, want to write code in a hot, hip language? Try Assembler. There are always new programming languages to tempt developers, but what's most surprising is one of the older languages on that list of popularity, Assembler. According to Tyobi, the Internet of Things is responsible for the rise, from 11th on the list last year to 8th this year, of a language that first saw wide use in the 1950s. It's slow, it's dangerous, but by golly, it gives you access to the hardware and it's small. So if the IoT is part of your job, plan to get down, get deep, get funky, and learn yourself some assembler.
No dongles for USB Type-C to HDMI. HDMI licensing, the outfit that decides what is or what isn't HDMI compatible, is releasing HDMI alternate mode for USB Type-C devices. The gist is this modification to the licensing terms for USB Type-C means you will eventually be able to get a simple cable with an HDMI connector at one end and a USB Type-C on the other end with no complicated electronics in between. Super good news for Apple users, but any new platform that has made the move to USB Type-C is also going to benefit big time.
That does it for the blips. Let's go ahead and jump straight into the bites. Now, you know that I love to talk about telco companies behaving dishonorably, and boy, did we find a doozy. AT&T is using a loophole to wiggle out of providing super cheap internet to the poor. Now, when AT&T purchased DirecTV, that was a merger condition imposed by the Federal Communications Commission to make them provide internet service for either $5 or $10 a month to people with low incomes. AT&T accepted this because it was the only way that they could push through that deal. But now it seems that they found a way to weasel out of it. AT&T is working around this requirement in areas where the company has failed to upgrade its network to anything that resembles modern internet service. In other words, if you live in a place where AT&T has not spent the money to upgrade your download speeds to at least 3 megabits per second, you can't get the discount, and they're not legally bound to provide it for you. Now, this was supposed to be offered to low-income households on the Federal Supplemental Nutrition Assistance Program. We know that as SNAP. But when the program rolled out, a significant number of households were told that they don't qualify, and furthermore, they will never qualify because AT&T doesn't intend to deploy to those areas. Even when it was proposed to modify that deal to ask for at least 1.5 megabits per second, AT&T didn't go for it. So this is another example of a company that agreed to something that they're not intending to provide. Chiebert, I want to throw this to you first because I feel the anger boiling up, and anger leads to hate, and hate leads to me saying really bad things on the stream. This, I mean, did you get this inkling from the beginning that AT&T was going to find their way out of this? Because when I read this, I could have gone two ways. I could have gone with, well, maybe AT&T is finally trying to do the responsible thing by giving this utility to the people who need it the most. But the other side of me was saying, nope, they're going to find a way not to do it. Which way did you fall?
Oh, no, we called it on this one. This is really and truly a catch-22. They have less bandwidth in certain areas because the people in that area can't afford internet services, so they don't spend money on upgrading. But because they didn't upgrade, they're not obligated to provide what is in essence lifeline services for internet, because the federal government now considers internet to be a necessary tool. Man, talk about a catch-22.
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, this is, I mean, you can kind of understand it. I do have sympathy for a company like AT&T, which has to do rollout of fiber networks to areas that are never going to recoup the cost. Google has found this out with Google Fiber, that doing any kind of deployment, even a deployment where you can easily get the permits, which in most U.S. cities you can't, is going to be very expensive. I mean, we're talking on the order of $5,000 to $10,000 per house that you pass, or something like $50,000 per mile of open field. So this is not a cheap proposition. And if you're talking about deploying to a very, well, not economically well-off area of the country, that's a cost you will never recoup. You will never be able to get back the capital you're going to put into the project, because by the time you start to break even, it will be time to upgrade the infrastructure. But, and Chiebert talked about this, the catch-22 is AT&T now knows if they ever did upgrade those areas, they would have to offer those services at discounts, so they would lose even more money. So rather than forcing AT&T to deploy services to the people who need it, it now gives them a financial incentive not to do it. Curtis, I'm sorry. I got to ask the super general question. How do you fix this? Is there a fair way to go back into the contract and make AT&T own up to the spirit of the deal?
Is there a way to do it? Of course there is. Is that way likely to be implemented? Probably not, because as you say, what it would involve doing is one of two things. The simple thing is to define down where the broadband access is. And the easy answer there would be to just broadly include DSL. That's simple. That would do nothing but cost AT&T some bucks that's now going straight to its bottom line. The much more expensive proposition would be somehow to force AT&T to start upgrading their infrastructure. Many years ago, under the system that was in place where AT&T was a de facto monopoly, that would have been much easier. Now that there is, in most cases, something that approaches genuine competition, even if it is competition from a cell carrier, that becomes much more problematic. So the easy thing to do is to rewrite the contract, define down where broadband is, but that requires political will. And I think that we have at least, call it 3 months to wait before we know whether there's any chance of someone in government mustering that kind of will.
Right. Unfortunately, that does seem to be the case. You know, one of the other issues that I think we should probably talk about when we're talking about this particular program is the fact that AT&T, remember when they took that $200 billion of tax subsidies in order to deploy a next generation network throughout the United States, they claimed that their DSL did count because anything above 1 megabit per second does, under their definition, count as broadband. Now they're turning around because they're looking at the statutes of the contract, and they're saying, well, that's not broadband. If it was broadband, we would have to provide the discount service, but since it's not broadband, we don't. So on one hand, AT&T is claiming that they were entitled to the money that they got from the federal government because they did provide broadband, and on the other hand, the same company is saying that they don't have to offer discounts on service because they don't provide broadband. This, Chiebert, as far as I can remember, this is the first time I remember a company defining and undefining broadband pretty much in the same breath.
It happens all the time, though. You know, as the P.S. Chop said, yeah, this 1995 broadband. Yeah,
Right.
Yeah.
It's broadband compared to like a 300 baud modem, I guess. I guess all things are relative, right? Right, Curtis?
Well, it is indeed, and we have to remember that after, you know, let's call it a century of being in business, there is probably not a company in the world that is better at reading and interpreting contracts and regulations in their own favor than AT&T. They've had a ton of experience at it. So yes, they're going to do this. I suspect that if there is enough of a stink made, we'll see some sort of negotiation between the FCC and AT&T, and some more families will get the subsidy. But I don't see an end to what is a legitimate digital divide in this country for a long time to come.
Chiebert, we've got JJ to the 4884 in the chat room, who's summing up what a lot of us are thinking, and that is, can the FCC do anything? I mean, I've totally bought into Tom Wheeler. I think he is actually on the side of consumers. I think he's done a fantastic job as chairman of the FCC. This is right up his bailiwick, but I mean, he's already fighting a lot of fights. But between the net neutrality fight and opening up the polls, which he did, and now going after set-top boxes, does the FCC have the free cycles to fight this? Because it seems as if it affects disproportionately those who do not have a political voice and maybe won't get the same representation up in D.C.
Now, I don't know, but Tom Wheeler does have a nuclear option. It's called Lifeline Services.
Right.
If the FCC redefines internet in the same category as telco, that's the nuclear option. And it lays it out so that the poorest consumers get internet practically for free. And I don't think AT&T wants that because it's going to cost them a boatload of money. And in case of Lifeline, if someone, say a farmer, qualifies for Lifeline, even if AT&T or whoever the carrier is has to run two or three dozen poles just for that one customer, Lifeline Services says they have to. Again, the nuclear option. I'm not sure Tom Wheeler wants to cross that, but that is one of the quivers in for his arrows.
Yeah. I do feel a little bit of the rage coming up. And the rage is this. AT&T, Verizon, and the other telcos who have been fighting back against the net neutrality regulations that were accepted last year, they make a lot of arguments as to why they shouldn't be regulated, why the FCC shouldn't have that power. But what it comes down to is it's an appeal from those companies saying, look, trust us. We will do what's right for the people that we serve. We will do right by our customers. And yet time after time after time, we get this. This is not even a unique example. This is just the latest example of one of these telcos, one of these ISPs, saying, well, you know what? We know it should be our job to provide what we consider a basic utility, but we're not going to do it because we can weasel out of it with a bunch of our high-priced lawyers. Curtis, I want to throw to you a question that Chicken and 21 is asking the chat room, and I think it's very germane to this discussion. Should we, do we consider broadband a utility? Is it in the same category as water and power?
You know, that's a really good question, and it gets... You know, there's a lot that's wrapped up in that, from political philosophy all the way to the changing nature of a technological world. I know people who, frankly, wouldn't consider landlines a necessity. I know others who consider far greater technological advances than just broadband necessary. I think that in the modern world, for a lot of reasons, it might be time to look at it that way. For a number of reasons, not least of which include the emergency nature, the fact that we have seen in the past that in times of natural disaster, it is not infrequent for internet service to last longer than voice telephone service, especially cell service. Most cell towers have a requirement for, I believe it is either 48 or 72 hours of battery. And if a disaster lasts past that, then cell goes away. And finally, the economic impact. There are a lot of farmers and less economically advanced individuals who can open up work opportunities and, frankly, open up new entrepreneurial opportunities if they have access to the internet. So I think this is a healthy discussion to have, and I think it's a proper discussion to have. Personally, I am coming down more and more on the side of it being a basic necessity, but I know that I'm coming from a couple of positions that make that my default. So I'm willing to listen to other points of view. I just think they're wrong.
Yeah, you know, I'm with you. You know, 10 years ago, when I first heard the internet is utility argument, I said, no, that's silly. The internet is a luxury. It's something that's nice to have, but it's not the same as water. It's not the same as power. But Chibert and CR1 in the chat room has a very good point when he talks about you can't have a good quality. You cannot run a business today without good quality internet. It's almost a prerequisite. When we talk about utilities, there's always a discussion about level playing field. Everyone should have the same basic foundation through which they can chase what we would call the American dream, chase a better education, chase business opportunities. Do you think you can chase a good education, a decent business opportunity without the internet?
No, I don't think so. In fact, as a cost-saving measure, a lot of social services can only be applied for by filling out a web form. And the pundits are saying, well, they can go to a library, you know, an internet cafe. Well, if they can't even afford the coffee, how are they going to use the internet cafe? So they're creating this giant catch-22 for the, I don't like the word disadvantaged, but maybe economically disadvantaged. They are being forced to use the internet, but yet the internet's costing them too much money. So I am of the opinion that, yeah, maybe it is time that internet becomes the same category as Lifeline services.
Yeah, it's It's weird. And I think we are in the middle of a paradigm shift where we will consider something that had been considered a luxury to previous generations an absolute necessity. But it should be noted, that's not the first time we've done that. Remember, electricity used to be a luxury. We would not consider it a luxury anymore. It's an absolute prerequisite for living in a modern society. Same thing with running water. So perhaps we're just evolving as a society. At least I'd like to think we're evolving and not just devolving into a YouTube comment section. All right, let's go ahead and move on to the second bite because I don't want to get bogged down. We do have a fantastic guest coming up. Chibert, you know what? I'm going to let you take this because I need to sit in quiet for a while and rant.
Well, here it is. 5,300 Wells Fargo employees have been fired for making 2 million fake accounts. So I'm actually going to read this section from Ars Technica. Since at least 2011, Wells Fargo employees have been creating fake accounts using customers' identities to boost their sales numbers, as stated by federal regulators this last Thursday. The Consumer Financial Protection Bureau fined the bank $100 million after a third-party consulting firm found that 2 million fake deposit and credit card accounts had been made without the consent of the person whose name was on the account. According to CNN Money, the bank fired 5,300 employees for taking part in the scheme, which only constitute about 1% of the bank's payroll. So here's how this scam worked. In order to boost their sales numbers, employees open 1.5 million deposit accounts and 565,000 credit card accounts on customers' behalf, but without authorization from those customers. Employees then transferred funds from consumers' authorized accounts to temporarily fund the new unauthorized account. The widespread practice gave the employees credit for opening the new accounts, allowing them to earn additional compensation and to meet the bank's sales goals. The problem is, by moving that money around, now all of a sudden these customers are getting hit with overdraft and bounced checks and all this kind of good stuff because the money's been moved. Oh dear. This is horrible, decrepit, dishonest. I'm starting to vibrate here. So, Padre, let's watch you vibrate for a little bit on
this. Well, I was vibrating on the AT&T story. You're vibrating on the Wells Fargo story. Curtis, we got to get you vibrating on something at some point. We got to get you a story that you're going to get angry about. But all right, let's talk about this. Now, the reason why we're talking about this on This Week in Enterprise Tech is because this was enabled by network technology. This was enabled by the system that Wells Fargo has put into place to allow for the easy transfer of funds between customers and between different banking institutions. It's very secure. It's very nice. But it was not protected against employee malfeasance. I should mention that this is not a fraud that happened now and was discovered now. This has happened over the last, I think it was 5 to 9 years is when they were picking up traces of this. And they've been firing employees for the last 5 years. It does strike me, though, that none of these employees have gone to jail because my understanding is what they did was wire fraud. You cannot fraudulently transfer someone else's resources for your own personal gain without it being a federal crime. So I'd love to see where that goes. Something else I would like to mention. Now, we're not a political show, so I don't want this to fall into politics. I will say that one of the two main party candidates has suggested that one of his first acts would be to dismantle the CFPB, that's the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau. But again, I won't mention which candidate. Just know that he really wants to do that. This sounds like something that should have safeguards against it. Curtis, if this happens to Wells, and Wells does have one of the more protected networks, and the they have some of the best IT folk in the banking industry, it does raise questions about how the rest of the banking industry is protected against this kind of fraud.
Well, let's look at what this is. This was not an intrusion. This was not a vulnerability of the IT system. This was a vulnerability of their operational system. And that's a very different thing here. You know, in the IT world, we can protect against IT vulnerabilities. Operational vulnerabilities are something else. Because as you say, the system was explicitly set up to allow this to be done. And I think with every step that these folks took to do these fraudulent account setups, we can look at that individual step and say, ah, there's a legitimate reason why we would want someone at the bank to be able to do that on behalf of a customer. The problem that I see is twofold. Number one is the imposition of utterly moronic performance goals. This is something that's happening all over a bunch of industries. I can frankly name IT suppliers where I have seen the results of stupid performance metrics and them causing the company to do, or individuals within the company, to do stupid things because they have metrics that don't make sense in the context of the larger business. So that's one side. The other side is the business analytics side. And we really were supposed to be past the point at which business analytics would catch this kind of activity. This tells me that Wells Fargo, in their business analytics operation, and frankly, in their compliance auditing function, were short. They didn't do what they were supposed to do, because in one or the other of these, or both, there should have been a giant red flag because things weren't as they appeared. My suspicion is you had these accounts that were being opened, one financial transfer in order to open it, and then nothing. They just sat there. That's atypical performance, and that should have triggered an analytics flag. We're seeing failures on a lot of levels, but to me, the first one and the one that should be addressed immediately is this whole performance metrics issue. The problem is that strikes at upper management, and we know from previous banking experience that, they are too big to fail.
Yeah, Curtis, you bring out an absolutely essential part of this, because it's easy to focus on, oh, that employee did a bad thing, that employee committed a felony, that employee committed fraud, but it was the performance metrics, and it was the push to meet the quotas, coupled with the fact that there was no sort of network check to make sure that the financial transaction should have also been a network transaction, they kind of combined to make a perfect storm of opportunity for fraud. Chibert, let me throw that back over to you. When you have such a competitive system as you do in banking, and when you do have the higher-ups forcing more and more quota because they want to make their division, their particular bank, their particular branch, their particular mortgage, whatever it might be, look really good on paper, is it the job of the IT folk to make sure that the people who are already supposed to have access to network resources are using those network resources appropriately? In other words, if I'm the IT guy at Wells Fargo, is it my job to wonder why there seem to be so many transactions from one or two tellers in a particular branch? Or do I just say, hey, they're on the permissions list, they've got the right resources allowed to them, and they just do what they do?
It's a lot of this is, it's not in my job description, or it's not in my pay, or it's above my pay grade. The problem is a lot, the IT is supposed to implement policy, not make policy. At least that's what it is in a lot of places.
Right.
This is, you know, I want to go and quote in the chat room, Brad Fubacher. My experience has been that performance metrics seem to get pulled out of thin air. And I see this not just in banking. I see this everywhere. I've recently seen it in a particular trade show management company.
Yeah.
Where are these metrics based on reality?
In many cases. You even see this in academia. You've seen it because
this has been one of your
job responsibilities at UH.
Yeah, it's like, oh, you're 10%, you're 15%. You know, you get people sliced up. But yet your expectations are, well, even though I'm only paying for 10% of your job, I want 100% of you. It's related, you know, it's because expectations are rarely based in reality. And I blame, you know, my personal opinion, this is my personal opinion only, is that a great number of these pick things out of thin air and don't need to base it on reality is this current crop of MBAs. You know, I don't think they have any basis in reality. And I like what Google and some of these other people and Facebook have done. They will not hire people with MBAs in this, under many circumstances. I think that's a really good move because I think the world of the biz school is got no basis in reality anymore.
We do need to move on because I want to get to our guest. I want to give him his fair time. I will say there's a good discussion happening in the chat room right now with Specs and Beatmaster Chickenhead about, you know, what is the responsibility of IT? And unfortunately, well, actually, I'd say fortunately, that's not an easy answer there. You can easily say IT is not a cop. And yes, that's true. It's not IT's job to spot these sorts of irregularities. But then I think all of us, everyone in the audience, everyone on this panel needs to ask ourselves as people who work in IT and who do have visibility into information that other layers of hierarchy may not have visibility into, we do need to question if we need to start clamoring for a larger voice as people who with our tools and our skills can actually spot fraudulent activity. Is it time for IT to become more than IT? Well, maybe we'll cover that in a future episode. Now, when we come back, we've got Jeff Hastings, the CEO of BrightSign. He is his company is at the forefront giving us compelling retail enterprise signage. If you've ever wondered how we get those beautiful displays, this is the man who can tell you. But before we do that, let's take a moment to thank the sponsor of This Week in Enterprise Tech. And this sponsor actually brings you Twiat. And no, I don't mean it like when we talk about other sponsors who bring you Twiat. I mean, literally, this sponsor brings you Twiat because the sponsor is Sonic. Now, Sonic is giving Twit a 10 gigabit per second pipe to the internet. Yeah, no, really. It's really, really fast. And we need that because we live on the internet. In fact, we were just discussing this in the previous story about what is required for business. And for us, it's all about bandwidth. And Sonic gets us. Now, Sonic's mission is to bring internet freedom to all with unlimited and uncapped internet. Let me say that again because that's important. Unlimited and uncapped internet. They believe that that should be the standard, the rule, not the exception. Sonic delivers residential and business fiber to the premise networks with gigabit connectivity in San Francisco, the North Bay Area, and the East Bay. Their internet services include 15 email accounts and 1 gigabyte of storage, personal web hosting with a new domain, and fax line service. Now, for only $40 per month, Sonic offers you download speeds of up to 1,000 megabits per second. They've got a home phone connection with unlimited local and long-distance calling, which is included with all of their services. They don't like to bundle. They just like to give it to you. Now, switching from your current carrier is easy, and you can keep your existing phone number just like you would with a move from any of the larger reputable carriers. Standing up for your privacy, friendly and local customer service, uncapped bandwidth, affordable pricing for all products. Yeah, folks, this is Sonic's legacy. Their customer advocacy is paving the way for a better state of the internet access in America. And this is why I'm so happy to have them as a supporter of the Twiat Riot, because they get it. They're not just an ISP. They're not just a broadband company. They're not just trying to sell you service. They have gone through great personal costs, great personal expense to bring competition to where it had not previously existed. And for me, Sonic is about as good as it gets. Folks, do yourself a favor. Join the internet revolution. Visit sonic.com/twit. That's sonic.com/twit and receive your first month of Sonic internet and phone service for free. Plus, bundle with Dish and save $120 on your Sonic bill. Visit sonic.com/twit. That's sonic.com/twit. And we are honored to have Sonic as a supporter of the Twiat Riot. Let's get to the action. We welcome to the show Mr. Jeff Hastings. He is the CEO of BrightSign. Jeff, thank you very much for coming on to This Week in Enterprise Tech.
Thanks for having me. I appreciate it.
We've talked up a little bit about what BrightSign does. We've discussed a tiny bit in teasing to our audience about what it is that you can provide. But in your words, if you had an elevator pitch, how would you describe what BrightSign does?
Well, if you think about when you're walking around every day, you see digital signs. So it's basically it's TVs, if you will, or monitors outside the home. And what we make is the equipment that bring those to life. So you see it every day. Sometimes you don't realize it, but every retail establishment, almost every fast food restaurant, all have some kind of TV displaying information. And that's what we do. We do it in retail. We do it pretty much everywhere. And it can be everything from architectural type signage to, you know, cool art to digital menu boards to promotional items, you name it. We bring the TVs outside the home to life.
Now, there's going to be people who are wondering, okay, that sounds cool. I mean, yeah, of course, I've seen digital signage. It's the new thing. I'm walking through an airport. I'm walking through a mall. I'm at a restaurant. I'm driving down the freeway. I know what digital signage is. But what's the challenge of digital signage? Why is there a company that specializes in this? Isn't it just me hooking up a computer to a screen and letting it go?
Well, that's where it all started. I mean, people would take just normal computers, hook them up to screens, and then you get disaster effects with that. You know, you see the Windows blue screen of death on a 50-foot billboard. You walk up to a cafe where they're using digital menu boards, and it's all black. It's like, what are we going to do? We have no way of displaying our menu. So what we do is basically take what would typically be a computer and make it an appliance. And I always joke with people, it's like you can have a general purpose thing or you can have a specific device for the job. And you walk into everyone's kitchen and they have a big oven. And that oven, it does a lot of things, including toasting bread. But then I look around in their kitchen and they've got a toaster. Why do you have two devices doing the same thing? Because that oven is a horrible device for toasting bread. And the toaster toasts bread really well.
Absolutely. Now, tell me a little bit about what you had to do to make a device that could do this well. I mean, yes, we know we're past that first generation where it was just anything that could display something became digital signage. If you want to do it professionally, what are the challenges you're going to have to overcome? I mean, what are the things I'm not thinking about if I think I want to put a 40-inch display in a public area?
There's a lot of things that come up into it. The first thing is brightness. Most people, if you take like a TV that you put in your living room, it doesn't have very much brightness to it. It'll typically have around 300, 350 nits, which is the amount of brightness that it generates. If you put that in a retail establishment with bright lights, it'll look super dim. You'll be very disappointing. And quite frankly, no one will look at it. So one of the things is buying a monitor that's going to be bright enough. Second is buying a device, a computer that's meant to run 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, because most of these devices are left on all the time. And if you look at a normal computer or any kind of small device, those things are just not meant to be running 24 hours, 7 days a week. And the power supplies overheat, the electrolyte capacitors in the power supplies go out and they die, and then you get these black screens. And then the last thing is the software. I mean, if you put a PC in there, it's got Windows or it's a Mac, what do those things want? They want to do updates. They want someone to interact with them. PCs love to have people play with them. Our devices, they're built so that only when they want someone to have input or to interact with them do they need that input. Otherwise, they fix themselves. If something goes wrong with the media, they can completely recover themselves all over the internet. And those are the kind of things that you build into a device that's kind of commercial grade versus consumer grade.
You know, this strikes me that this tends to be the narrative of the internet. This is, I mean, when you think about Google started off with off-the-shelf computers for their data centers. And that was actually a big story back then. You know, they didn't want customized hardware. They wanted to just use what was out there because they wanted to reduce costs. Well, as they grew up and as they matured, they realized, no, there's actually an advantage to having customized hardware. And there's actually an advantage to designing something for purpose rather than taking a general device and then using it for a specific thing. It sounds like you're talking about the same thing. The first generation, maybe even up to the third generation of signage, was taking something we already had and then just using it. And, you know, yeah, there's going to be a couple of bugs. There's going to be a couple of flaws. Maybe things break more quickly than we think they will. But it's cheap and it's easy to deploy. It seems as if you're saying we're now getting to that point where we're realizing digital signage isn't a fad. It's not going away. It's taking over. And so if you want to continue in this field, you need specialized hardware. You need to actually think about the purpose rather than just throwing something up. What does that do for hardware design on your side? In other words, how has that pushed you to make better digital signage?
Well, there's a few things. The first thing I talked about was the power supplies. I mean, no one ever thinks about the power supply. I mean, it's like, oh, you just grab one of those little wall warts and it powers it. Well, those things die very quickly. And when those die, the whole device dies. Secondly is these devices need to be tucked behind displays. They need to be very small. So one of the things we did in our latest product design is redesign them so that they're all less than an inch thick. You think, oh, that's not easy. It's an easy task. It's just shrink it down. It's very difficult because the operating environments for these things can be very hot. So the other thing that we did, we built the case out of aluminum, which allows us to dissipate all the heat out of the device and have these things sit in environments that are up to 70 degrees C, which is over 150 degrees Fahrenheit. So you think about putting a computer in that type of environment, it's just not going to last. It's going to melt down. So as you look at the little page there, you can see the industrial design looks cool. We think it's, even though it's industrial design, it should look cool, but it's totally functional, super thin, and be able to operate in these temperatures that are totally extreme. I mean, most people would never think of putting electronics into something that's 150 degrees. I mean, things are cooked at 150 degrees.
Right. All right. So we're looking at the hardware right now. I think now is a good time to come in for a landing and actually get to the brick and mortar. So someone's considering deploying signage. What would they be looking at? What are the considerations they should put into their decision making about how many displays, how many locations, remote access? What can BrightSign offer to me? If I were to say I want to install X signage, how would you guide me through the deployment process?
So the first thing you do is like, what am I trying to accomplish with digital signage, right? I mean, am I trying to have a digital menu board? Am I trying to sell some product? Am I trying to display some information? And try to look at the placement of that. So you determine your screen size. The next thing you want to do is once you've got the screen size, say, hey, what's the resolution? Today, 4K monitors are about the same price as 1080p. If you really want to make a really nice appearance, put in a 4K display. It's going to look better. It's going to attract people's attention. Make sure it's a bright display, as I talked about earlier with the nets. Second, I mean, the next is make sure you got a good internet connection. You want to be able to upload the content. You want to be able to change the content on a frequent basis. And then one of our BrightSign devices, a totally dedicated computer that's going to sit there. It takes all types of content, can take video, can take images, HTML content, pretty much anything you can throw at it is going to look great on that display. So you put all that together, and then you can easily have a SaaS-based management that's going to give you easy management of whether it's 5 devices or 500 devices. A lot of people make the mistake of, oh, I'm just going to update them with a USB stick. What happens is that works for 1 or 2 devices, but when you have 100, 500 that are geographically dispersed, literally getting out there and trying to put a USB stick or someone taking the USB stick ends up really making those things not usable in the real environment. So I think those are the first steps that you get. And then the last piece is have someone that's going to be updating the content. Make sure that you've got compelling content and you're updating it. Otherwise, it's like anything else. It gets stale.
Right. I mean, your really expensive, really beautiful digital signage becomes just kind of a comedy of errors when it's displaying something from an event that happened a year ago. And I have actually seen that. That's no bueno. So let me understand this. Not only do I have hardware connected to my monitors and however many monitors I might be using, but BrightSign actually has a back end that allows me to control all the devices I might have deployed?
Yep, we have a back end. It's a cloud-based service, like kind of all the contemporary clouds, and easily allows you to update the content, look at the devices online, check their status, check their health, update anything that you want on those things. And if something requires maintenance, you can remotely manage a bunch of it. Obviously, if something's gone wrong with the hardware, it will let you know that. But most of the time, these things are recoverable over the remote control.
Okay. Yeah. And this is a network show, so I would be remiss if I didn't ask you, how do you protect your devices against malicious attack? So, I mean, if someone knows that BrightSign devices are connected to public displays, to public signage, it becomes a juicy target because it gives me the ability to push things I want. What kind of authentication do you have built into the devices and into the service, into the back-end service, to ensure that only authorized users have access to their devices?
Yeah, so we use 128-bit encryption for everything. Everything is encrypted between our devices and our servers. Every piece of content that basically lands on our device is hashed, and we check the hash on it before we play it. We have encrypted files that have the hash in them. So we have a lot of security around that, because that's one of our biggest vulnerabilities is, or concerns about vulnerabilities, is someone taking over these signs. Because, you know, we have almost a million devices out there, and it would be really fun to crack those devices and put stuff on those displays. So we go through a lot of effort on the security side to make sure the content is in fact encrypted and it's protected. And when we go to play it, that we're actually checking to make sure that content is the right content to play.
Right. And actually, that is really, really important, because if I have a piece of digital signage that represents my company and someone owns it, they're going to associate that with my company. And that would be a really, really, really bad thing. I'm assuming that you also have controls in your back end that will deal with things like theft. It will tell you immediately if a device goes offline because someone has just yanked it off the wall. How do you deal with that part?
Yeah. So, you know, we can tell that it's gone from its current location. And we also have measured in there that you can actually tie it to the monitor. So if someone unplug it from the monitor and display it somewhere else, we can detect that. Not all of our customers use that, because sometimes they'll be changing out displays, but it is available that you can actually check the monitor and make sure the device is connected to that monitor. The other thing we can do is, if we can detect if someone tries to use it for different content, we can blacklist it from the server. So even though they have it, it'll do nothing.
Right. That's the same approach I see for a lot of AP manufacturers, which is, yeah, you could steal it. It will do you absolutely no good. This won't work without a service, or it won't work without a controller. So why go through the trouble of trying to take it? All right. So let's back up just a bit, because our audience is a bit discerning, and we've got a good question from Crystal Red in the chat room who wants to know, who would you consider your main competitor? So when you're looking at how this market is developing, and it is a big market, and it's a market with a lot of potential profit, who is it that you compete against, and what would you consider the holy grail? What is the thing right now that if you could do, it would give BrightSign just a huge competitive advantage?
Our competitors are PCs. I mean, if we get market share numbers, and we do have number one market share in this market, but literally the next 5 to 6 competitors are all PC manufacturers. And, you know, honestly, we've kind of overcome them in terms of the basic technology. The biggest thing that we come up against in terms of, you know, competition with PCs is there's so many IT departments that their whole jobs depend on servicing PCs. So bringing in a device that's not a PC starts to threaten their existence. So they continue to buy PCs, even as horrible as they are as endpoints for digital signage. So there's really no holy grail for us. It's mostly just getting the IT departments to wake up. And it's like, hey, put this secure device out there at the endpoint versus putting a PC to keep your job.
Right. Now, from the know-how side of my brain, I'm wondering, I know that these are designed for signage, so that's what they're marketed for, and that's what the back end really does. But would I be able to pull in content from other sources? I'm specifically thinking of deployment within an academic setting. Like, could I have these deployed in a commons or in large auditoriums and then push content through them, through the BrightSign devices, so that I could display at the same time, you know, in sync across a large number of monitors, a large platform?
Oh, yeah. So, you know, the nice thing about our devices is you can synchronize them and do video walls. We actually just finished up a little summit here of BrightSign users. And a guy in Italy at the World Expo had 432 displays all synchronized, connected to BrightSign displays. So imagine a video wall with 432 displays all synchronized. Wow. And these are perfectly frame accurately synchronized, and we use an internet protocol between the players to synchronize all their clocks, so we get frame accurate playback over an incredibly large number of displays. I saw the video of it, and I was just blown away. It was like, wow, that is an awesome display.
If you've got your own internet protocol to help with synchronization across devices, that really does give you a leg up on the PC solutions I've tried, because that's always been the Achilles heel. You could get it close, but there, you might be a frame or two off on different machines. And you could just kind of see it if you looked at it through the corner of your eye. What about multiple monitors? So let's say I want to make a video wall. Do I put a bright sign device on every one of those monitors, or do I break it out into individuals?
Yeah, so you break it up between, you put a bright sign behind every display. The nice thing about that is we know that our devices for one screen gives you 100% video performance. What a lot of people fail to take into account when they use a PC with multiple heads is like, yes, you can get a desktop with that many pixels, but the video decoding, you can't supply quality pixels to every screen. So what happens, either it looks blurred because you stretched it, or you start dropping frames because the decoder on the PC can't keep up with it. So with our devices, you put one per display, super easy. They're very small devices. And then everything is synchronized so that if you've got a 4K screen, it's perfect on that 4K screen. If you have 24K screens, you're getting 4K pixels to every screen. And instead of looking at the video wall from afar away and saying, yeah, that looks cool, and you get up near it, it's like, wow, that really looks ugly. In our case, is the closer you get, the more detail you see. And we see it being used a lot in luxury retail where they'd only used print before. Now they're using 4K monitors because it's almost like moving print images in luxury retail.
We've got some of our users in the chat room, like Rev Danuga and not Beatmaster, but Creamy Cormcob. Yes, those are actual real names. The chat room is a wonderful place. It's magical, really. But they're wondering, and I don't know if you could tell us this, where could they specifically look for signage being driven by your products in markets like, say, New York? I mean, they're asking as tech fans. They kind of want to see these things in action.
You know, if you walk into a Best Buy, most of the displays in Best Buy are actually run by our bright sign players. If you see the Samsung display with all the multiple TVs, there's a bright sign behind kind of every Samsung TV, every LG TV. The GoPro displays, you've probably seen the little GoPro kiosks, they're everywhere. Every display has bright sign player running the little GoPro video. Every Bose display, every Sonos display. So those are just some of the ones that are incredibly prevalent throughout the world.
Let me bring my co-host back into this because I see Chibert in my little avatar monitor there. He's chomping at the bit. He has been working on digital signage for a long, 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 long time. And actually, he is the perfect narrative for BrightSign because when he started, he was doing the PC thing and he was trying to synchronize across the displays and make big video walls. And then he started running into custom solutions like BrightSign and he realized much better way to do it. Chibert, do you want to describe for us your digital signage journey?
Well, first it was a PC with a quad Matrox card. And then I said, oh, this is cool. Let's use Raspberry Pis. And I think I burned up like 3 or 4 Raspberry Pis before I gave up on that. And one of the local integrators here, AV company, introduced me. They were showing me some displays that they have in their lobby that they've designed for the K-12, Department of Education. They use these to put up school announcements, videos, all kinds of different things in the schools, and the Department of Education in a central location can push these configs out. They actually use the cloud. Now, I'm also using the BrightSign with a touchscreen interface so that I'm gonna bring up a picture of our main research vessel. You just click on the cameras and you can actually go through and take the video feeds off of Wowza server to look at any of the deck cams, health, safety, go on a thermal camera so you can watch what's happening with your experiment on the back deck, even if we're in a squall, all kinds of good stuff. And the reality is the platform does allow for this. I can mix video, I can mix audio. I'm reasonably sure I'm going to be able to go and take a web page that's going to have our compass repeater. The bottom line is that it's much more durable. It uses significantly less power than a traditional PC. There's a lot of places I can put it that I can't put a real PC. A Raspberry Pi is a good example. I love Raspberry Pis, but you burn them up really quickly when you start putting them into really hot places. It makes a pretty big difference. And I should add, you do not have to have a BrightSign connected to a public internet. It can be completely isolated, like our ship thousands of miles out. See, we just update the flashcards and run everything from the flashcard.
Jeff, we've got an interesting question from JJ to the 4884 in our chat room. It wants to know, could BrightSign be used to, say, display content from a gaming PC or a console? Maybe, you know, a venue for a video game, the Cyber Professionals League.
Yeah, so one of the things that we do is we build a model that actually has HDMI in, and you can put that full screen, or you can, you know, window it. You can do whatever you want with it. But, you know, our model has HDMI in, actually takes an HDMI 2.0, so you could actually feed a 4K feed from a PlayStation or anything else and have it 4K coming out, or we can actually downsample it to 1080p. We can even take that stream and encode it and send it over, you know, a local link. And with an upgrade that's coming pretty soon, we'll actually be able to stream HDCP protected content. Right now, we can take in HDCP protected content. So if you had, you know, a satellite receiver or a cable box that was encrypting the link via HDCP over the HDMI link, we can take that in, window it, rotate it, do whatever you want with it, and then put it out, and it's and still maintain the HDCP encryption, because we built that all into the architecture of the box.
Very nice indeed. Curtis, let me ask you about this. I mean, I'm geeking out over this. I love this idea of centrally managed displays. I love the idea of being able to manage all of my digital signage or all of my classroom monitors, wherever it might be, wherever I might have a BrightSign device hooked up. But is there common understanding at the executive level of the enterprise that this is a good thing? Do they see the benefits of centrally managed branding across any digital signage that an enterprise might have?
Oh, I think there's very much that understanding. That's the sort of thing that that an executive would see and go, well, of course, that makes complete sense. Especially when doing so offers what is ultimately going to be a lower total cost of ownership than putting separate machines out there that have to be separately maintained and separately managed. This is the sort of thing that makes a lot of sense from an enterprise perspective. And I think that as it becomes accessible to more and more enterprise system connection, then it makes even more sense. You know, we start to see things like centrally composed and managed campaigns that go out to different locations. You see things like analysis of traffic patterns being used to dynamically reroute content from place to place. So I think these are both easily understood and very exciting for a lot of the executives, especially those over on the marketing side of the house.
Indeed. Al, I do want to continue. And actually, Jeff, I want to invite you. This is one of those topics where I think our audience gets a better understanding of it if they actually see it assembled. I want them to see how easy it is to do. And I'm thinking we have a show called Know How. It would be cool to do a live assembly of like a multiple BrightSign display and then have you actually control it. Is that something that you think we could do?
Oh, that would be awesome. It's super easy to do. It'd be really easy to set up. We could do a live demo. We could drop content on there and we could watch it play across the multiple monitors. And I think most people would just be blown away at how simple it is.
Yeah, we'll have our people talk to your people, because I'd love to do an episode where we do it with a PC and say, okay, we can kind of make it happen. Now here's a dedicated device. Because I think if you put them back to back, people understand what we're talking about, the value proposition here. Now, unfortunately, folks, you've done it again. You've used up another hour listening to the best dang enterprise podcast in the universe. That's according to 9 out of 10 pieces of digital signage. Jeff, I want to give you the last words. This has been a lot of fun. You've opened us up to something that Chibert has been salivating over for the last year and a half, 2 years. Could you please give us the last word about digital signage? Tell us about BrightSign. Tell us about where you want to go. Tell us about where we can go to find your products. And ultimately, tell us where we go on the internet to find BrightSign.
Well, hey, thanks so much. So, I mean, the first thing is brightsign.biz. That's our URL. But if you just type in BrightSign to Google, it'll direct you to the place where to go. And the thing that I really just stress with people, if you're going to put up you're in the enterprise or anywhere, you're going to put up a TV to have any kind of information, please don't put a PC. You will be so disappointed. buy a bright sign. You can buy them off our website. We have plenty of integrators that will get you the TVs and put it all together for you. And you will be much happier, and everyone in your company will be much more excited about seeing this thing work and being updated. And, you know, to see the pictures rolling there, we do everything from cool exhibits like the Shark Tank right here, which was done in Dubai, to coffee menus, to information displays. So if you're going to do it, look to BrightSign. We'll help you out. We'll give you everything you need. And you'll be the hero instead of the person that everyone thinks is a moron because the PC is down.
Actually, that's a really, really good point. You could be the hero rather than the guy who came up with the broken solution. Gentlemen, thank you so very much. Jeff Hastings, CEO of BrightSign, we thank you for being on This Week in Enterprise Tech. We're going to invite you back. We're going to invite you to our other shows because this is actually a very cool piece of technology, something that's right up our alley. Thank you for joining us for This Week in Enterprise Tech.
Thank you. Take care.
Of course, I need to thank my co-hosts because I wouldn't want to do this show without them. They're the ones who make this fun. Of course, starting with Brian Chiebert. He's the geek in paradise. He's the guy who dodges hurricanes like no other. Brian, can you tell the folks where they can find you and your work?
Well, I am on Twitter at ADVNETLAB, Advanced Net Lab. And I'm going to plug next week's show. Big show. We've got VMware on, so be there or be square.
Indeed. So if you missed the VMware episode, you really have only yourself to blame. Also joining us is Curtis Franklin. He is the second part of our trio of co-hosts. He is, of course, my personal guru when it comes to all things executive in the enterprise, and he is the host of Information Week Radio. Curtis, what's happening on Information Week Radio in the coming week?
Well, something that I'm real proud of is a podcast that we just put up today. It's part of our Information Week's Expert Voice series, and I sat down over the phone with the CIO of Yamaha. Now, that's not the motorcycle company. It's the musical instrument company, but it was really interesting talking to him about how he designed an IT infrastructure to support some of their very creative employees who support their extraordinarily creative customers.
Brian, Curtis, thank you again for joining me, and thank you for being my brain, because as we all know, I'm really just the eye candy. That's how that works. We want to thank everyone who joins us each and every single week. We couldn't have this show if it wasn't for your support. 4 years running now, talking about all the enterprise goodness that we can handle. We want to do something for you. We want to make it easy for you to get Twyatt everywhere. Just go to our show page at twit.tv/Twyatt. There you will find all of our back episodes in case you missed them and you want to download them for later consumption. But you will also, and this is important, find a subscribe button. If you want to support This Week in Enterprise Tech, if you want to see us continue to provide you with enterprise goodness, choose a version of your choice to be downloaded into a device of your choice. You can have the audio version in your iPhone so you can listen to us on your way to work. You can have a video version on your Galaxy S7 so it can burst into flames during your break. You can even watch a high-definition video version on your Mac, your PC, your laptop, or your desktop to see us in all your HD goodness. Again, twit.tv/Twyatt. Also, don't forget that you can follow me on Twitter, twitter.com/PadreSJ. There you will find out what I do when I'm not on Twit TV shows and when I'm not tinkering with enterprise tech. Again, follow me and suggest a couple of guests. And don't forget also to follow Chiebert at ADVNETLAB, Advanced Net Laboratory, so that you can suggest your topics for future episodes of This Week in Enterprise Tech. Finally, I want to thank everyone here in the studio who makes this show possible. Of course, to Lisa and Leo for letting us continue to do This Week in Enterprise Tech. To, our fantastic producer, Chiebert. Again, remember, he's the guy who brings on all the guests, and he's the guy who sets the dock. He really is a sort of a jack of all trades. And I've got to give special thanks to our TD, Kevin. Kevin, can you say hi to the folks and tell them what it is that you do at Twit TV?
Hi. There's no camera on me, so...
Okay.
You can see my arm or something.
Yeah, well, Kevin, we know that you're a big fan of sharks, so we got to ask you the question, because we ask you a question every time we finish the show.
There are 5 gills on each side of each shark.
No,
except for the 6-gill shark and
the
7-gill shark.
The answer was red, but thank you for playing. Oh, maybe you'll get it.
That's when they bite something.
Indeed. Until next time, I'm Father Robert Ballester, the Digital Jesuit, reminding you that if you want to know what's going on in the enterprise, just keep quiet.